Firstly, can I have any apologies for absence?
Chair, we have apologies from Councillor Leach, Councillor Abbey, Councillor Gilchrist and Councillor Hale, substituted by Councillor Angela Davies, Mike Sullivan, Chris Garubia and Les Rollins, who's not on the
Chair,
And we also had apologies from Councillor Matthew Patrick, Cabinet Member, who's here to observe, but he's got the court to do it. I haven't had any apologies from Councillor Doughty. So,
okay, well, we've had the apologies, so we can go on to the agenda. The first item is the members' clothing under. Are there any declarations of interest?
Yeah.
Don't have one, don't say no, if everyone agrees with that.
I have no interest.
No, I have no declaration.
Two quick points before we start then. First, I want to welcome Gemma Mack-Jones, who's now part of our administrative team in the Town Hall. Welcome to you, Gemma. I would be virtually saying goodbye to Tom Salt, who isn't leaving the council yet, but I believe this will be your last meeting with this committee, Tom. After, what is it, how many years with the council? 44 years? I believe you started when you were 16 in 1973. It doesn't look a day older. But anyway, Tom, we want to wish you all the best. Working together with you. Would somebody please call the minister to record?
Yes, no problem.
Okay. All agreed on that?
Yeah.
Okay. In that case, I'd just like to change. I'd like permission to change the order of business today. Chris Hines, who we were expecting to have Chris's come, but Chris has a very good reason for needing to leave early. So I'd like to bring Chris's item forward on the agenda. Now, if you could all agree to that, are we?
Yeah.
Okay, Chris. So this would have been item 8, if you'd like to turn to item 8 in your back. It's on page 61. Now, this is a topic which had previously been identified by Mark. It was a topic that was escalated in June by Esther Cabinet, and this is the update for greater information on the channel.
Thank you, Chair. Good evening, everyone. As Chair's intimated, this is a report which is updating the committee on action taken to address attendance management issues. Very specifically in the audit report was around under-reporting of absence and taking action in line with the policy and procedure. As part of taking that forward and looking at our overall approach to attendance management, we've developed an attendance management action plan along with workplace wellbeing strategy. So in terms of the action plan, we've identified that in terms of a number of objectives. We're seeking to develop a culture where wellbeing is valued and supported, to improve the management of attendance in line with the policy, and to target response to key issues in order to improve wellbeing and attendance. Key themes of the plan are around leadership and communication. In particular, the communication and leadership around the expectations of managers to manage attendance and to manage the well-being alongside staff in the workplace. Further training and support, the professional training for managers, is a very specific desktop training which is aimed to address the issue coming out through the audit report around managers being absolutely clear about how they go about reporting attendance and what they need to do on an operational basis. We've also developed an improved performance management reports, which I'll say a little bit more about in a moment. Action addressing the causes of absence and the workplace wellbeing strategy. In terms of taking forward the action planning, we've identified some key areas across the council which have some of the highest areas of absence, for a number of particular reasons, which were shown in performance management plan section, where we've got individuals who've been up more than 60 days, the number of highest occasions of absence, number of days lost, and a detailed summary. What's different about the performance management reporting are two things. The first is that we have a focus on managers managing absence, which is again the action from the attendance report. So we are focused on the data. We're focusing on how managers are managing absence. So we have detailed reports to show the number of return to work interviews that have taken place, the number of informal meetings that have taken place, and then tracking through any formal procedures that might need to be put in place. And so that senior managers are able to manage their managers' performance in terms of how they are addressing attendance in the workplace. The other difference in the reporting is that managers actually have a very good support per individual. So what they'll be looking at is the employee as a person and their history, the number of absences that they've had and the reasons for that, so that they're able to anticipate issues and have those discussions with the staff in sort of one case. It is their own self-service system and they can see that, but they will be able to look at that and track that. So for example, if a member of staff has two periods of absence, and the trigger would normally be hit on the third absence, they ought to be having a conversation at that stage. They should have a conversation as soon as they're back to work, but so that they are managing attendance upstream, and they're having discussions with the individual employee about their health and well-being. Those actions will help to address the issues that came out of the report in terms of being absolutely on top of how the manager is managing attendance. In terms of long-term absence, we do have, like a lot of organisations, we have long-term absence at a lot of organisations. We've introduced a case conference approach involving legal and OH advice to deal with some vulnerable and difficult issues where individuals are at stake and are very unwell, and we need to look at how we are managing them in the future. We've redirected some HR support to introduce and support the new performance management framework, so that actually we have time spent at our management teams working with managers and working sort of alongside them to be able to use the data to look at how they're managing their absence. The desktop training is underway for managers, and we've got a number of managers that are to be trained in those areas. So in terms of future activity, we're launching the new workplace wellbeing plan and our approach to attendance management across our management cohort senior managers briefings, which we set up for the new year, and communication will be going out before the end of the year. The further training support is underway. We've been running workshops for managers about having the absence conversation. And the performance management compliance, we've had discussions with our managers around that and introducing that. And the targeted training is underway and in one to the service area in terms of taking that forward.
Okay, Chris, I'm absolutely not sure who had the first hand.
David.
Sorry, who's the David?
Then David.
Right, thank you, Chair. I've just draw your attention to page 68 and 69 of the report. One is the cost of absence, which is obviously a very great concern to us, but my concern also related to 1.4 on page 69, which is showing that more than a third of the absences from the council activities are due to mental health issues. And I just like, really, if you just try and give us a bit of a profile on what those are, whether they're people who are seriously, permanently mentally ill, or whether it's related to individual stress situations either in the workplace or at home, and how something is being done about this, because about a third of people are ill with mental illness. The cost it's incurring is quite frightening, quite disturbing.
Yes, okay.
So through you, Chair, I wonder if you could just comment on that for us.
Okay, could you just clarify the point? The percentage of people who are off with mental health related absence is 35% of those people who are off sick.
Yes.
Yes. And in terms of their absence and mental health, the term mental health absence is used as a generic term. We can break that down further in terms of stress, anxiety, and depression. There isn't a sort of one particular that is most prominent. There are a number of things that we do know, and we are in line with most organisations, for most organisations, both public and private sector, for most organisations, the highest reason for absence is stress. That doesn't mean to say that's not an issue that we should be addressing, or it doesn't sort of minimise the issue by any means. And the first thing that is really important about it is that when individuals are suffering from psoriasis with a whole variety of different reasons, very often it's about one issue that triggers stress in the other case, but it's a whole host of reasons that are contributing to it, both within and work. What we've been able to identify in one particular area, and children's services is a good example, where kids' home management is really, really important. And a lot of work's been done through the improvement plan to allocate numbers of cases, look at the number of cases and the number of social workers required to deliver to support those casework, and implementing an increasing number of social workers. That's one of the areas in which we're looking at reducing the amount of pressure in work. Stress is very much people's response to pressure. So we put work in place with the teams to look at resilience and how they respond to some of the pressures that they have. The other piece of work is that in those areas, we've identified a number of areas and only 41 managers where we have the highest instance of stress across the council. Those managers are the managers that we're targeting for the next stage of stress awareness and how they manage stress in the workplace. We have a first aid referral for stress and to occupational health so that they immediately are able to access any support they need and they have some immediate assessment. So there's a number of things that we put in place to improve that sort of managing stress when we see and are aware of it. That's why the workplace wellbeing strategy is so important, because it's about having healthy staff here, present and performing. And a number of those areas are looking at how we access and work alongside public health in terms of their campaigns. We're able to access some of the work that they do. But we'll also be introducing some further work around wellbeing through an occupational health contract. Also introducing some of the activities that take place that can help to reduce stress in workplace, such as physical activities, etc. So a number of issues.
Just a supplementary quickly, if I may. The key to this obviously is identifying the problem while it's still able to be managed and not leading it so long that the person goes off and is ill for a while.
Yes.
But the other problem that I've identified from personal experience in the past is people being promoted to a level that they can't cope with in terms of obviously you get your current job based on the performance in your last job, and so if you're not careful you get promoted to your own level of responsibility. Put it that way, where you can't do the job that you've been promoted to. Is there ever an element of that in what's going on? In other words, people not receiving enough training to be able to cope with their job properly and therefore suffering severe stress as a direct result of it. It's an element that I've experienced in the past. I just wondered if it's an element that you were considering.
Yeah, it's perhaps a bit. It may be that in some cases, and I can't comment on whether it directly is. I think it is more that the workplace is changing and the demands of the workplace are changing and evolving, which is the case in a lot of organisations. And you know, for people who've been here, it's actually supporting them through some of the changes. So for a lot of people, those sort of changes and the uncertainty is something that causes anxiety for individuals.
Thank you.
Okay,
Hi, welcome. Why was I having a phone about you?
Thank you. Two points of my mind here. Could you tell me what level we're at with appraisals? Because the last time we talked about appraisals, I think you were asked, you were told that you were aiming for 80%. Can you tell me whether they've been achieved or why it's 80% or 100%? The second question is stress is a very sort of difficult thing to address. One of the things you mentioned was 141 managers that are going to be doing some training on stress and stuff. Are these 141 managers, are they actually managers, or are they being put into a place of management because somebody's either left, moved, or are they actually managers? So giving them a title of managers means they can manage. So my question now, that 141 managers are struggling. Are they managers, or are they just being put in that position, which would cause stressful relationships?
That's it, if you've had a breakdown.
Thanks.
In terms of the appraisal, we've actually gone over the 90% mark in terms of the appraisals taking place. So we are following up on those last appraisals. Some of those are around people who actually are sick or what the position is, and the funding is at the moment, so we haven't been able to include that figure. In terms of the 141 managers, they are managers who are managing teams where, so they are managers in services that have the highest level of stress. So it may not be that as managers they're struggling, it may be that actually some of the work areas, there are some difficulties and some work issues that are actually causing that. So it's in the first instance that we're talking to them around recognising it, but we'll then go in and do some work within the teams as to identify with them what's causing that. So actually get to the causes of stress. Where there is a higher area in the teams, there is more likely to be a correlation with work pressures. So we need to go in and spend more time doing that. As to whether they are maybe promoting managers, I couldn't comment, actually. But we could go away and look at that and see some trying to be interested.
No excuse, Mr.
Right, a few questions. First of all, on page 63, I'm just a little bit concerned about what you put by there. Develop a culture where well-being is valued and supported. It's almost like you're saying that well-being leads to good health. Which is a pretty general statement, and it almost makes people who don't feel too good feel a little threatened. So that's my first question, I think, views on that. Then the next point is on 68 again, the levels of sickness. You said that sickness absence is currently around 10.73 days long. Then you said that target is 10.75. So does that mean that we've achieved our target? Because it's in other places it says it's slightly different. And then on page 10, and again it's in other parts of this report, of the report it says 76 there. 100% attendance, exception for long-term sick and maternity. Do we not imagine people might get like neurovirus or something like that? Do we expect them to come in?
Sorry, I do think about what measure you refer
to. 76. I can't understand why you would expect to have 100% attendance, because everybody gets something once in a while which would be antisocial to come to work with. So are we actually saying that people've got to come to work with vomiting and diarrhoea? Unless I'm misreading it. And then the other part of it that worries me a little bit is stress. Where does things like stress bowel, stress headaches, things that can be masked as stress drinking, come into it? Because you're almost asking these managers to be a pseudo-medic. And it's often quite difficult, isn't it, to see the difference between somebody who has a reactive mental illness and somebody who has a chemical mental illness. And you can go so far in this, but I'm worried, because I've got a background in mental health also, that you might kind of be masking things or overstepping the mark, or people might suddenly become experts in things, and that does worry me a bit. But I also do feel that you've looked at kind of one aspect of stress. If somebody kept being ill because they had upset stomachs or whatever, or they had IBS or whatever, would you say that was stress? How far does this stress go in it? It's not good.
Yeah, we've made a number of points, just try to work through those. The first issue raised is to do with the Tennis Management Action Plan and what we're looking to do in terms of page 63.
Yeah.
Develop a culture where well-being is valued and supported. I'm sure you can understand why we put it in. I understand what you mean about threatened, because there is a concern that people actually can feel sort of even more alienated. I think when we looked at it, and again we worked alongside public health and some of this, and to look at some of the studies, it's what we're looking to do is to focus on well-being, not just attendance. So the attendance management plan isn't just there to say there's a policy and you've got to follow it. It's there to actually say we're interested in having our staff well and in work.
Yeah.
So that's why we put that in.
But if you are feeling, if you're feeling under the weather, non-well-being, then that would seem quite different to you. And I accept that a lot of organisations put this wording in, but I think it's very old-fashioned, and I think we need to relook at that in terms of people appreciating that people are looking to keep their internal well-being well-being and not looking for signs that they might not be, and say, you know, if you're not 100% bouncy 100% of the time, then, you know, you're not valued and supported. Because we don't want to employ manics, do we? Got enough of me. Well, next one.
Okay, thank you. You referred to
68.
Page 68. Was this 1.1?
Yeah,
and numbers, actually the current number, the projections change during the year as each month reports, and so on a monthly basis we change those projections. Last year, the target this year is 10.75, currently our projected performance is 10.23. Last year our performance was 10.72. So yes, we are on target to, we are progressing to be able to hit the low target for this year. But that doesn't mean that we should take our foot off the pedal. We've got a lot of work into managing absence and attendance. So actually we need to continue and to build on the work that we've put in place so far. Okay. The next was really the issue about stress.
No, the next was why you would say that, how will we know it's been achieved? And the answer is 100% except for long-term sick and maternity. So you'll never achieve it if somebody goes to Iron Park Hospital to visit somebody and comes back with neurovirus.
Yes. So in terms of the achievement, it isn't actually 100% attendance in terms of managing attendance. It's actually attendance at the workshop.
Right,
so actually, I think it's about interpretation.
So why does it say exception for long-term sick and maternity?
Is that actually, when we set a target of 100%, we usually take off, so the 100% is achievable because you take off those people who aren't currently at work.
Well, why don't we have it to 100% of the people in work?
You could do.
Right, and the last one is just about around stress.
Yes. And I think that's perhaps a more difficult issue, which is why you raised it. What we know is what's presented to us. So when an employee gives their reason for being sick, they may give their reason for being sick as stress. However, they may give the reason for being off work as an illness, which may be stress-related, but presents itself as a bad stomach or consistent colds or whichever it may be. That's why we need to be able to be on top and to notice patterns of absence. I think the challenge, as you say, for managers, is that actually they can't qualify, and they're not qualified. So actually, we need our occupational health support to be able to support managers when they have concerns around absence.
Who would they see in occupational health? Would it be a prescribing nurse? Would it be a doctor? Who would it be?
There's triage with a qualified nurse.
A prescribing nurse or just a nurse?
My next chair.
Your next, then Jeff, then Andrew, and then Chris. Did you want to come back?
It was just a quick point.
Oh, that's specific. I don't know if you should be asking, because it's the same point.
Quick question. Do we have, it's very easy for somebody to be off work and put them down as stress. Just as we obviously discussed, stress manifests itself in the world at a different point. It's very easy just to say, suffering from stress, haven't they? Do we have a list of the illnesses that people are off with? Do you collate that sort
yes.
of thing?
Yes.
And how much of that is down as stress? And do you just accept stress as a reason for being off work?
Okay. First thing is, yes, we collate it. It comes under the heading of mental health related issues, so that's 35%. So stress is part of that 35%. You can self-certify up to 5 days off work. So if they wish to self-certify, that is their choice. Over that, there would be certification from a doctor, and the doctor would write down what their assessment is. what we do do when people are off the stress or talk about stress or manage their stress in the workplace is we give an immediate referral to occupational health. So occupational health will then report back as to their assessment of the individual and whether there are actions in the workplace that can be taken to help minimise the pressure or to enable them to agree to be able to deal with the pressures that are there.
Okay, now I've got Mike Sullivan, Jeff and Andrew.
Thanks, Jen. These figures are really alarming. When it's costing the council £4.4 million in absenteeism, and then 1.3, page 68, Human Resources and Development Commission of the Internal Audit Report to investigate concerns of under-reporting. So that suggests we don't even know what the true figures are. It does smack to me of a lack of management with these figures. Now, it is stressful, and the NHS is suffering from the people who work in the NHS are suffering from terrific amounts of stress. But it does. This whole report, I think, is quite alarming. Reasons for absence. Now, you've got 35% who are suffering from mental health, which 99% of them think would be stress. What's the figure? What's that 35% a figure of? So the absenteeism. So we've got 35% who are suffering from mental health problems. What's the figure of people who are off ill? What is that figure? HR records, page 69. HR records that relatively little formal action is being taken by line managers to address unacceptable levels of attendance in line with policy. Again, you see, that smacks of poor management. So it seems to me, running throughout this report, is a lack of management at senior management levels, because that's why the senior managers are employed, to overlook the middle management, who then overlook the people on the coal face, if you like. So, and you use terms like, well, we're taking action to try and alleviate some of these problems. How long have you been taking the action? You also said, we're not going to take our foot off the pedal. Well, if you've got your foot on the pedal with these figures that are being quoted here, it's quite alarming. And I'm thinking in a holistic way here, because we are talking about people's lives here, people under serious stress. It smacks of a culture, dare I say, what I'm going to say, an uncaring culture, that we've got to look after our staff better. And I'll take the members to page 75, and I think what's written there is really, it's quite alarming that, you know, you're using terms like, well, we've got to phone people up, having the absence of conversation. Now, we're talking about people who could be, and it should have been, when we get to page 75, it smacks to me that there's a lot lacking right through the system to get to page 75, where, and you talk about 100% attendance, well, that figure will never be achieved, so there's a waste of time putting that in there, in the report. Oh, that's the training that Christina's just said. Managers do not hold back from having difficult conversations. What exactly is a difficult conversation? And I take it that that's on the phone, or is somebody going out to knock on someone's door? What exactly does that mean? So it is, and I'm the mayor deputy here tonight. I'm not on this panel all the time, but it is concerning. Having read all this report, These issues are concerning, Alec.
Okay, just to address some of the issues that you've raised, I've actually got a paper which has got some breakdown of the figures over there, which I'll just get in a moment. And one of the issues that you've raised actually, which is one that, you know, is of concern, is actually, you know, managers engaging with and talking to members of staff when they arrive sick and having those difficult conversations. And this shouldn't be a difficult conversation, they should be a normal everyday conversation about somebody, how they've been.
Well, why are you both having a difficult conversation in here?
Because that's the feedback from managers, that they find it difficult. So for managers and are concerned about intrusion, they're concerned about privacy and a whole number of different reasons. In terms of their daily sort of what they're getting there to do, getting on to do, it's them spending the time sitting down with a member of staff and talking to them about we missed you. And it really is that simple, and that's the messages that we're giving out. And in terms of, you know, well actually we've been doing this for a while, we have been doing this for a while and we'll continue to do this. The figures are actually reducing very slowly, and we are beginning to have a better level across the region in terms of our performance compared to other councils. But it doesn't make it good enough, and that's why we've got the, you know, the updated plan and the workforce wellbeing strategy, because we recognise that it just isn't good enough and we need to move forward. We need to be supporting our employees to be healthy as far as we can and to be work, and managing attendance as an everyday management action.
Jeff?
Yeah, thanks. Thanks, this, Chris. Sickness and sickness policy used to be discussed at the Employment and Employment Committee. It's probably not had that role kept with it. And I see that the Employment and Employment Committee for this week was actually cancelled. And I think, as we've already worked out, there could be a lot of discussion around this in terms of bringing various expertise to bear. A couple of things, and I might have heard you wrong. You talked about the target 10.75 days, and we were coming in under that. But I think you said, and you might have misspoken, but when we start talking percentages, I thought you said last year it was 10.2, and this year we're estimating it being 10.3, which wouldn't suggest it's getting better, actually. It would suggest it's going the other way. So you might have misspoke, so happy to chat to that. The other one, just to agree with everyone, £4.4 million is a huge amount. I think it's probably 3-4 council taxes that people have to pay, or the percent on their council tax they have to pay to cover sickness. So it really is a serious issue. And you mentioned about 90% of performance management interviews have taken place, and I just wondered in how many of those performance management interviews objectives were set for the managers that said you need to make sure that you're complying, you need to make sure you're doing this, you need to make sure you're doing that. Do we, and so the question is, do we set objectives with our managers when we have them? The other point, and I don't think you answered Chris's question, which I thought was a really good one, and you know, we all work and we all understand these as issues as well. But what exactly is the tale? So, when I say tale, I don't mean the story, the tale in terms of the number of people acting into management positions. So, somebody goes off to do a project, so you ask, you know, Jack Green goes off to do a project, so you ask Les Rowlands to step up and fill his post. Les Rowlands is then saying, well, I've been there, they're asking me to do this, that, the rest of it. I'm not doing that, I'm only doing it temporary. Seems a load of hassle to me. So, what is the tale in terms of that thing? Because it doesn't just affect Jeff Green and Les Rowlands. It might well be Chris Carubian that's asked back up into what Les Rowlands was doing while he's covering for Jeff Green. So, that can have quite unhealthy impacts on the staff themselves, because usually Les would have been trained to do the other job, he's got to pick it up. And second of all, you know, all that extra work that's heaped on people. So I would like to know what that is if you've got it, please. We focused quite rightly on mental health, because 35% is a big figure. And I don't know whether we do a staff survey these days, but again, that's something employment might pick up. But I'd be quite interested in that staff survey, what the bullying and harassment figures are, for instance. So, picking up Chris's point around culture, it would be quite interesting in the staff survey to have a view from staff about what sort of culture this is. Is it a bullying culture? Is it a harassment culture? Is that how people do management? I've just told you to do it now, get it done. Or is there a different sort of focus? But also, not the other thing that I've kind of seen work quite well, I think, is mental health first aiders. In terms of what you've said about, you know, as soon as someone goes off, they get allocated to occupational health, that sounds very good. I think there's something before that, so we want to intervene before somebody goes off. And as I say, I've seen this idea of mental health first aiders working really well. So there's someone you can go and speak to. You might not want to talk to your manager, because if you're interested in your career or something like that, you might think, because we don't know what the staff survey says, you might think, oh, going up and saying I'm really struggling with this job is going to stop me getting the next job, because these things can happen and there can be a lot of baggage that gets, sadly, I think, but a lot of baggage gets hung around stress, wrongly, which can mean people suffer in silence, it gets worse, they don't want to talk to the manager, if the managers are talking to them, which you identify. So we need that belief in people to be on their own until they go off on the sick with stress, and then we intervene. So, as I say, mental health first aiders might be something you want to look at. But let's not forget the 65% who aren't off with mental health issues. And again, it's not broken down here. But what are we doing around that 65% as well, in terms of what we're doing to work out why it is? Are we doing all the health and safety assessments for people, you know, if they're working at machines, you know, all that sort of stuff? And then finally, you'd be delighted to hear, you talk about compliance, you talk about self-service and so on. Could you just talk us through it? Just pick it up on, I think it was page 75, we've got kind of over there, around sickness triggers. So, again, what I've seen implemented in various places is sickness triggers. So, if you're off whatever that trigger is, 12 days, 15 days, it automatically, the system generates an automatic note to the manager. It's on the shared service system and all that sort of stuff, where you need to go and have that interview. So have an interview with the person. It doesn't have to be threatening, it doesn't have to be necessarily performance management related. But it's a trigger to say you need to go, you need to have a conversation about the person. Even if it's 13 cumulative days, it doesn't have to be 13 days in one block, but it could be 13 cumulative days, for instance. And so the role of the manager then is to go and have that interview, find out what's going on, see what can be done, all that sort of stuff. Leave them with what you're going to do next. But enter onto the system and have that interview, and what you agree, and you both have a shared view. So what are our triggers? And are we, is the system, because I know we spent a lot of money on the system. So is the system generating those notices to managers, encouraging them to comply, and is the system recording? So this should all be system driven, so we've got some, don't just have a feed, we've got proper data to work on, whether those interviews are taking place. So apologies, Chair, for a number of points. I tried to scrutinise and to be helpful.
So, please don't apologise, Jeff. I mean, you did make a very lengthy statement, but within it there must have been a considerable number of points which I'm sure Chris will have noted. And I think your main theme was supportive of the idea of what's been done, but you did pinpoint a number of issues that particularly concerned you. I'm sure Chris has got no sort of maintenance arrangements.
Okay, thank you. Just the first point was around the figures of what one allowed to sell or would come over. The current target for days this year is 10.75 days lost per election. Yeah, and the current absence level is actually 10.23 at the moment.
And that was the question.
And last year we have over there on his paper, but I'm just going to get it. So I'll just move over and get that for a moment. Okay. In terms of the 4.4 million, the lost time, yes, I acknowledge that, which is why I'm saying this is a serious issue. It's lost time, obviously we need to address that from a wellbeing issue, a cost issue, a number of issues. Thank you. In terms of performance appraisal, how do managers have their objectives set around absence? We've introduced accountability statements at a senior level in the organisation, and that's for assistant directors and above. Those accountability statements talk about the management of attendance, management of appraisals, and a number of different issues that are within those accountability statements. We then have a number of objectives that are cascaded into managers' performance appraisals, including management of attendance. So the answer is yes, we've set those objectives. It's the first year we've cascaded them into all managers' performance appraisal, but we also did put them into senior managers the year before. In terms of the managers acting into managers' positions, I said I recognise that we do have managers who are acting into managers' positions, but couldn't give you the data on that at the moment. And of the 141 that were targeted in those service areas, how many were acting into it, I didn't have that data in front of me. But we would be able to get it and to have a look at that and to analyse that.
Sorry, just to be clear, Jeff, what you want to
say. If you want to pick up a quick point, please, but not another 5 minutes.
No, I'm just saying, I'm not interested in 141. I would like to see that, and if it was a point of point, I'd like to see the whole figure about the approach, about the afternoon that we've got.
Yes.
Well, that is for the future, that will have to be done. Yeah.
Thank you. I can find that, sure.
Angela.
Okay, it's really good to hear about the wellbeing strategy and also all the work that's going on in terms of enforcing the managing attendance policy. My question was, I think Mike referred to it, it was around the under and non-reporting of sickness. Where it's reported, it looks like you've got a robust action plan in place so that the policy is followed up, so it becomes normal practice, and embedded in the culture. I suppose what I was concerned about on page 69, point 3, I kind of read about sometimes where employees have been overpaid, and it said there have been some cases, plural, not one case where this has resulted in the employee being kind of overpaid, which has been a cost to the council, really. So I've got two questions on that. One is about, I'd be interested to know some more detail on what we think it's actually cost us, or at least what the known cost is. And then also what we're doing to check that any time people are off sick, that it is getting reported onto the system and therefore followed up correctly as well.
In terms of the under-reporting, we put a lot of communication and out around the reporting of absence. In one of the areas in particular, and I'll use children's services as an example, but they're not the only area where we've seen under-reporting. There are areas where they move people between teams, so actually their line manager may not be the manager on the system who inputs the absence, may not be the manager who they're working with on that day. That's where people can fall through the cracks.